not.
Oh, no, no, we're not doing the same one.
I know. That's our meeting.
That's our meeting. Yes, the lunchtime meeting.
It's gone.
So sorry. Okay. It was a busy day. There's a lot going on. But yeah, so the, unfortunately, we'll wait till next month.
Okay.
26th of October. Yeah. Right. I'm kind of clarified that. I'm so sorry. Are you confused?
Yeah. Sorry. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We meet in Christ's name. Let us
share this peace.
Well, with the large community of people that are here, let's stand and let's raise the roof.
That's
perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ.
Christ said, "The first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: Love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these."
Amen. Lord, have mercy.
God is love, and we are God's children. There is no room for fear in love. We love because God loved us first. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith.
God, our Father, we confess to you, to our fellow members in the body of Christ, that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We are truly sorry. Forgive us our sins, and deliver us from the power of evil. For the sake of your Son, who died for us, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And God, who is both power and love, forgive us, and free us from our sins. Heal and strengthen us by his Spirit, and raise us to new life in Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Let's say the glory. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth.
Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer.
For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father.
For today. God of our salvation, be with us when we call upon you, and bless us with your steadfast love and kindness, restore in us the beauty of your creation, and keep intact the gifts you have bestowed. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, and we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I am going to rain bread from heaven for you. And each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way I will test them whether they will follow my instructions or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather on other days." So Moses and Aaron said to the Israelites, "In the evening you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And in the morning you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your complaining against the Lord. For what are we that you complain against us?" And Moses said, "When the Lord gives you meat to eat in the evening, and your fill of bread in the morning, because the Lord has heard the complaint that you utter against him, what are we? Your complaining is not against us, but against the Lord." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining." And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, they looked towards the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, at twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God. In the evening, quails came up and covered the camp, and in the morning there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, what is it? For they did not know what it was. And Moses said to them, it is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat. Psalm 105. Give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him, sing praises to him, and speak of all his marvelous works. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Search for the Lord and his strength. Continually seek his face. Remember the marvels he has done, his wonders and the judgments of his mouth. O offspring of Abraham, his servant, O children of Jacob, his chosen. He led out his people with silver and gold. In all their tribes there was not one that stumbled. Egypt was glad of their going, because they were afraid of them. He spread out a cloud for a covering, and a fire to give light in the night season. They asked, and quails appeared, and he satisfied them with bread from heaven. He opened the rock and water flowed, so the river ran in the dry places. For God remembered his holy word, and Abraham his servant. So he led forth his people with gladness, his chosen with shouts of joy. He gave his people the lands of the nations, and they took the fruit of others. They took the fruit of others' toil, that they might keep his statutes and observe his laws. Alleluia. The second reading is about the Philippians. For to me, living is Christ, and dying is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labour for me, and I do not know which I prefer. I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary for you. Since I am convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with all of you for your progress and joy in faith, so that I may share abundantly in your boasting in Christ Jesus when I come to you again. Only live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or I'm absent and hear you, I will know that you are standing firm in one spirit, striving side by side with one mind for the faith of the gospel, and are in no way intimidated by your opponents. For them this is evidence of their destruction, but of your salvation. And this is God's doing, for he has graciously granted you the privilege, and not only of believing in Christ, but of suffering for him as well, since you are having the same struggle that you saw I had, and now hear that I still have. This is the word of the Lord. Amen.
This is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to Christ our Saviour.
Jesus said to his disciples, the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire labourers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the labourers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And he said to them, you also go into the vineyard, and I will pay. behaving what is right. So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same thing. And at the 11th hour, 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" They said to him, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You also go into the vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first." When those hired at about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage, 1 denarius. Now, when the first came, they thought they'd receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "Aren't these last worked only in 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us, who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat?" And he replied to one of them, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous? So, the last will be first, and the first will be last." For the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to Christ our Saviour. I've got a very short prayer here. Lord, let us help us notice the daily bread that you give us. Amen. Please be seated. Oh, that's a nice picture. Oh, it's gone. It was nice for a minute. I'm so glad James not here to be disappointed with me, but I am terrible at sport. I can't throw, I can't hit, I can't run, and I can't jump. And one of my worst nightmares at school was, you know when you join those big long lines of kids to be picked for a team, knowing that there are fewer places in the team than the number of kids to be chosen from. Is that okay? So who thinks that's a great experience, and who thinks that's terrible? Terrible. Okay, that's interesting, isn't it? The team was usually quickly filled with the best players, then the all-white players, and then the amiable tryhards, leaving behind a small and awkward group who failed to be chosen at all. The dread of being picked and then revealed to be a liability was matched by the humiliating realization that you had already been judged and not been worth picking at all. And it was just, I hated it, what a nightmare. Cue up, children. But part of the question to be considered today is, who is worth joining the heavenly team and who does the choosing? Who is most likely to get chosen first and who will be left hanging around in the square? Well, it's pretty obvious in this story who would be chosen first. The vineyard would select the workers who are fit, who look strong, and look like they could provide the best return for the agreed silver denarius, which is, depending on the translation, is what was paid, which was a generous day's pay. But can you imagine who's left behind? The sick? The elderly? Those with a physical handicap? The foreigners? The out-of-towners, and just the plain awkward. They'd remain in the market square because leaving was admitting that they had failed to earn enough to buy their daily bread. And failure to get work meant facing a hungry family, or worse, an angry wife. So the atmosphere in the marketplace would have been sad and rather desperate. And can you imagine? Change in the whole mood and the excitement just before sunset when work would finish for the day, just before sunset when they all got hired to work that last day for a whole day's pay. Everyone was considered worthy of inclusion in the workforce. What a feeling of thankfulness and relief they must have experienced. All of the workers, regardless of the time they worked or their ability, they were all paid a day's pay. All were of equal value in this vineyard. No one was left out at the end of the day. Which means today's good news is that God's world runs on an economy of abundance, where there is more than enough for all of us. We are loved and no one is left out. And one of the visible signs of that love is the provision of our daily bread that sustains us. And I think the idea of abundance, of everyone receiving enough to sustain them, I think it surprises us when we start thinking about it, because this is the opposite of what we anticipate from an earthly human economy, which operates on a basis of insecurity and scarcity, of having to qualify to get into heaven. We humans instinctively hoard what we find, and we compete with each other just to gain small advantages in that queue in the social order. Now, I can understand why that might happen in situations of survival, but even in times of plenty we behave like this. Think of the many times that we, as society and individually, have changed the balance of the natural world by taking more than our share, more than our daily bread. From species extinction to climate change, we have all had a hand in it. And this is a struggle of our own making, turning us blind to God's blessings all around us. And when that happens, it's hard to think clearly or even notice how God sustains us when we're stressed, depressed, or fearing what tomorrow might bring. So if God's economy is an economy of abundance, how do we stop worrying about scarcity and change our view of the world? Well, we don't make it easy for ourselves, messing with the weather and causing entire species to disappear, but our loving God desires that we all receive our daily bread. And to do this, we are gifted with very large brains to work things out and to help each other, rather than sit about waiting for our daily bread to simply fall into our laps. But what Linda read sounds like the Israelites did indeed expect daily bread to fall into their lap. And I started off writing this going, oh, blooming Israelites, whinging, like talk about whinging palms, whinging Israelites, my goodness, they never stopped. And this was 6 weeks into 40 years of whinging. But, you need to be fair, as slaves, they were probably provided with food, like a farmer would provide food for their donkeys or their oxen. They were simply livestock. They were used to being fed, not to providing or having to find the food for themselves. We have to be a wee bit kinder. But there was a throng of thousands of Israelites, and they now required to fend for themselves after generations of being dependent. And fear and hunger stopped them thinking their way out of the problem and to finding a solution. So they went and complained. And it bugs me, the phrase about God heard your complaining. You know, we're trying hard to worship God, and apparently complaining works just as well. So who's praying today? Give it a try. God, when are you going to make peace? See if some complaining will make a difference. It's worth a try, isn't it? Because sometimes you know what? But more seriously, the Israelites experienced a miracle that sustained them. When they were shown a sweet, naturally occurring substance that they called manna, which was all around them. It was all around them anyway. And the Israelites were mystified by it. And remembering that the stories in Exodus and Genesis were basically written as campfire stories, the name for this mysterious substance is, what is it? What do you call it? It's a bit like, do you know the daft myth about the kangaroo? Where basically the British explorers came onto land, and they talked to the Aboriginals, who obviously didn't exist because it's meant to have been completely empty land, and said, what is this strange creature that bounces? And the guy goes, kangaroo? As in, I don't know. That's the bit. So kangaroo is basically, I don't know. Do you not know that? So it's the same thing, basically, is a bit of a campfire joke. What is it? Just the manna. was that it was there at the right time to sustain the Israelites, and for so long. And there was probably lots of other forms of bush tucker all around them, but they were so busy complaining to start looking for themselves. And God pointed out the source of their daily bread that would sustain them. And it apparently comes from lice and scale creatures, and it's like a secretion that is laid on the branches of lots and lots of different kinds of bushes, different kinds of different species. And it is sweet, and it's a little bit sticky, and some of it, if you leave it too long, will indeed just get covered in ants and go frisky. You have to get up early in the morning. And people still use it. They grind up and put it in bread. And it is, and the Bedouin name has a bit in it that sounds like manna. So there you go. Two bits of useless information to share for the rest of the day. Well, I hope that you can find your daily bread, the blessing that God gives to you to remind you of this. It might be food. Are you okay? Do you want to drink some water? Okay. It might be food, but it might be recognizing that someone loves you, or even a safe space to live. It will be what you need to be sustained on that day. But when I listen to the gospel, I'm reminded of people who are less able, who are unemployed, refugees, or simply unable to maintain employment. People who are not our first choice of society. How does this gospel sound to them? Does it give them hope for a better future? How do they find their daily bread? Well, living in this country with social security, it should ensure that none of our citizens go hungry. But the growing need for food banks suggests that all is not quite as it should be with our safety net. And it's awful how quickly things go wrong, and how you can find yourself moving from the front of that queue, so to speak, to the far end of it. And the worst part of all is how little control we have over those circumstances. Life can feel very unfair very quickly. And with a little notice, your life can be turned completely upside down. And I think we used to not know that. How we have so little power. There could be a war that can break out in Ukraine or somewhere completely different that changes everything. There can be a financial crash that suddenly wipes out your pension savings or closes businesses. For an employer to change location of their businesses, a government to not maintain infrastructure and let dams break, or companies or countries that corruptly spend money that was provided as food aid, things that you have no control over that leave you unemployed, hungry, or even homeless. And you can become like those people who live here, living a perfectly middle-class suburban life when they go to bed and they woke up. If they were lucky, they were still alive. Well, they didn't wake up. But, you know, they were suddenly homeless and suddenly dealing with immense deprivation in all sorts of ways. And you can become one of those hopeless people hanging around the market square as the day ends without the blink of an eye. So take a chance to consider that queue. Where are you? Where are your neighbours in life's queue as we wait to receive our daily bread? Lucky are we compared to so many, even in our own community. We were just talking about the apex of the star. Instead of quietly accepting our fortunate place in the queue, our trust in God causes us to question the really unfair question. Why do we still find forgotten people in the market square? Why are there still families in Stonewall without enough to eat? So how can we be part of that solution? Ensure that everyone receives their daily bread, and it may be food, or maybe shelter, or whatever is required, but in a way that reflects God's love, with hospitality and dignity for all. Well, I think as Christians, our response has two aspects, a practical one and a spiritual one. And next week is Harvest Sunday. So what's your plans? Are you going to bring in extra food? Are we going to give food to Apex? I hope so. I know that certainly is the plan at the unions. And that's a practical way to show our gratitude, sharing what our surplus with those who have none. And we share our blessings and we multiply them so many more times than we can count. And then we continue our response by living a life that reveals our trust in God. We take the time to stop and pray, which increases our awareness of God in our lives and in our neighbours. And we begin to see those acts of compassion and kindness of people receiving their daily bread. If the least you do is say the Lord's Prayer, you will have asked God's love to be revealed to, as today's sustaining daily bread for all of us. It says, give us, not give me, our daily bread. And you will have asked for strength to forgive others and have recognized that we are all loved and forgiven every day by God. And you will have joined in the call for God's rule of fairness and love to be dominant here on earth as it is in heaven. And when we try to live as God desires, our goal is to ensure that everyone has enough to eat and that everyone is treated with fairness and dignity. And when we live this way here in Scotland, well, it doesn't have to be some unrealistic utopia. It just has to be a place where there will be fairness and no extremes of deprivation or hunger. But we know, because life is not a straight line, that there will be poor people and there will be sick people and there will still be food banks. But my prayer is that all are treated with dignity and love. In God's kingdom, there is still a queue. There is still a queue. But the first go last, and the last go first. But don't worry, because there is an abundance of blessings. Don't worry, we will all receive our daily bread. And the Lord be with you.
Stand faithful and firm on faith. Say the Nicene
Creed. We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of our substance with the Father. Through him all things are made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate of the Virgin Mary, as was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. So let us pray. Or complain to God. See how good.
Blessed are you, Lord our God. To you be praise and glory forever. Your Spirit moved over the face of the deep at the beginning to bring order out of chaos and light and life into the world. Pour your Spirit into our hearts and kindle us with the fire of your love, that we may reveal your power in our lives and walk in the joy of your presence. Blessed are you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. When I say, come Holy Spirit, fill our hearts, response, reply, is renew and refresh your creation. So come, Holy Spirit, fill our hearts.
Renew and refresh your creation.
Come, Holy Spirit, fill our minds, which without you would be dull and cold. Fill our church, which without you would be an empty shrine. We ask you to guide and strengthen all who preach the word or who teach the faith. We pray for all who are preparing for confirmation or for ordination, for all who are seeking to grow in faith and in relationship with you. Come, Holy Spirit, and fill our hearts. Renew and refresh your creation. We give thanks for all who are inspired and guided by you. We ask your blessing upon artists, musicians, writers and craftspeople. We pray for all who influence the minds of others through broadcasting or through their example of living. We remember today all who live in deprived or depressing surroundings. Come, Holy Spirit. Fill our hearts.
You refresh your creation.
We give thanks for the coming of the Spirit and the filling of our earthly home. We ask our blessing. We ask your blessing upon our homes and relationships. We pray that our friendships enrich each other and help us to be more aware of you. We pray for all who are taken into care and all who lack the love of a stable home. Come, Holy Spirit, fill our hearts.
You refresh your creation.
We remember all exhausted peoples, the world weary, the depressed and the discouraged. We pray for all who despair and all who feel that they can no longer cope with life. We ask your blessing upon our friends and loved ones who are ill, and upon all who have been involved in accidents this week. Come, Holy Spirit, fill our hearts.
Renew and refresh your creation.
We give thanks for the gift of the Spirit and the promise of eternal life. We remember all who have served you faithfully and now at rest in your kingdom. And this week we especially remember Nigel and also Eileen, because we think it's the anniversary of her death. We pray for loved ones and friends who are departed from us, that they may rejoice in life eternal. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
I'm still working through this thought about complaining. If you go look at the Psalms, lots of them, that's exactly what they are, aren't they? They're basically shouting at God, and maybe sometimes it is appropriate. In between worship. Come on then, let's do some worship. Should we stand?
Should we have our armpits already then?
Let's. Okay.
To bring our
Things visible and invisible, source of life and immortality, whom the heavens praise, the sun and moon and all the stars, the earth, the sea and all that is in them, in every place and at all times. By your holy word, you brought order out of chaos, you divided light from darkness and created the heavens and established the earth. You divided the sea from the dark land, dry land, and caused all life to come into being. When you had made the plants and the animals, you formed humanity in your own image and entrusted us with the priesthood of your creation. In Christ, your holy word became flesh, took our human form, lived among us, and through dying on the cross, overcame sin and death, that your creation might be restored in him. Through your life-giving Holy Spirit, who first moved over the waters, you renew your creation, call us to new birth in a world restored by love. And as children of your redeeming purpose, with all your creatures throughout space and time, we offer you our praise, together with angels and archangels, and the whole company of heaven, singing the hymn of your unending glory. Holy, holy, holy. Are we going to sing or say?
Holy, holy.
Christ is your holy wisdom, existing beyond time, present at creation. Through Christ you revealed yourself in the world and bring your saving work to its completion. Obedient to your will, he died upon the cross. By your power you raised him from the dead. He broke the bonds of evil and set your people free to be his body in the world. On the night he was given up to death, knowing that his hour had come, having loved his own, he loved them to the end. At supper with his disciples, he took bread and offered you thanks. And he broke the bread, and he offered it, and he gave it to them, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, it is broken for you." And after supper, he took the cup, and he offered you thanks. And he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant. It is poured out for you and for everyone, that sins may be forgiven. Do this in remembrance of me." And you now
obey your son's command.
We recall his blessed passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and we look for the coming of his kingdom. Made one with him, we offer you these gifts, and with them ourselves, single, holy, living sacrifice. Hear us, most merciful Father, and send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon this bread and this wine, that overshadowed by his life-giving power, they may be the body and blood of your Son, and we may be kindled with the fire of your love and renewed for the service of your kingdom. So help us, we who are baptized into the fellowship of Christ's body, to live and work to your praise and glory. May we grow together in unity and love, until at last in your new creation we enter into our heritage in the company of the Virgin Mary, the apostles and prophets, and of all our brothers and sisters, living and departed. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be to you, Lord of all ages, world without end. And the living bread is broken for the life of the world.
Lord, unite us in the Son.
And as our Saviour Christ commanded and taught us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Jesus, redeemer of the world, we acknowledge.
thanksgiving for your love in creation, and have shared in the bread and wine of the kingdom. By your grace, plant within us a reverence for all that you give us, and make us generous and wise stewards of the good things we enjoy.
Amen.
Let's get the kettle on.